Today's species spotlight is on a species of old world or Asian rat snake that I don't think gets enough love, especially when compared to like the bamboo rat snakes or even the beauty snakes. And that is the Russian rat snake. Now, the Russian rat snake has several different common names. There's the Amur rat snake, the Siberian rat snake, the Manchurian black rat snake, the Manchurian water snake, the Manchurian or the Russian or Siberian black racer. All these are the same animal, and it's a really, really cool species of snake. So first things first, they actually belong to the genus elaphe, which any of you rat snake aficionados out there knows that was essentially the original rat snake genus. And still it started to branch off into Pantheropus and several other species out there. So this is actually elaphe shrenckii. At least I'm pretty sure I'm pronouncing that correctly. We all know how I am about the Latin name, so. Now, this species of rat snake does come from Russia, but not just from there. They also share their entire range with northern China and parts of Korea. And in fact, most of the range actually isn't inside of Russia. Like several other species of reptiles out there, that's usually what we call them for one of usually two reasons. The first one is the country that they very first were exported from into kind of the wider world of reptile keeping. And the other one is generally it also is named after essentially who is the one who is discovering it. So if a researcher came in, even though people in the area already knew about it, they would call it that where they first discovered it, even if a large population didn't exist in that area. So in a lot of times, those people are Europeans who go into the rest of the world, who rediscover things all over the place. And in this case, the Russian rat snake was named after a Russian zoologist, Leopold von Schrenck, hence elaphe shrenckii. Pretty sure I'm still saying all that right. We get it. I'm bad with names. Now, with that being said, this is a really cool species of snake, as I've probably said at least three or four times by now. This is a pretty large rat snake. A lot of the snakes don't get too large, with the exclusion of like the Mullendorf or the hundred flower rat snakes or some of the beauty snakes. This rat snake does average around 6 feet in length and a little bit heavier body too. And in fact, there are some anecdotal references that they may even reach up to 8 feet in length, which is a pretty big rat snake. A lot of them hit around the 4 foot range. I haven't seen too much actual legitimate documentation about that 8 foot range, but that's still 5.5 to 6 foot is a decent sized old world rat snake. Now, when you look at it very first, you can tell that it's a very striking animal. It looks like a poor man's, you know, mangrove snake or even a Bolan's python. So it has that very dark brown to black to indigo wet ink looking color, and then it has those thin whitish yellow cream to actual a nice highlighter yellow along the underside of its jaw and along its full body. Now, the fun thing about these guys is like the green tree pythons and the emerald tree boas, they go through an orthogenetic change, which means that when they're hatched or born, they don't look like they're fully mature genotype, or phenotype, I should say. Genotype's the genetics. So they don't look like they do as adults when they're born. They're a lot of times called the ugly duckling of snakes, because when they're very first born, they're actually kind of this kind of muddy brownish gray color. And as they mature and grow and shed, they turn into that beautiful, striking, amazing looking poor man's mangrove snake. And in fact, they look very similar to another species of snake that shares a big part of their range, and that's the Korean rat snake. That as it gets older, it does change color a little bit, but not to that dark brown color. It has a few different other colors, and I'll do a whole other species about Korean rat snakes down the road. But because of that, a lot of the time, people will sell baby Korean rat snakes as Russian rat snakes. And once they hit about 2 years old, they realize, oh, this is a Korean rat snake, not a Russian rat snake, although they are very similar in a lot of different ways. So when we think about the area where these snakes are found, they're found in northern China, Russia, parts of Korea, where in the wintertime it can get very cold. It snows in a lot of those regions. And so this snake, being larger, being darker, it's better absorbing that UVB, that ultraviolet, that heat, as well as being well adapted to colder climates. They also are found in all sorts of places. A lot of the times they are found usually in kind of marshy areas or areas where it's like grasslands leading up to the forest. And they're kind of right in that little area. A lot of times they're found in those marshes, as I said before, which gets their name, the water snake or the black racer or things like that. That's very indicative of other species of snakes that are often found in those habitats. They've also been found at a lot of really weird elevations. There are some decent mountains in parts of China and Korea and Russia. And in fact, they've been found at elevations of over 6,600 feet, which is, I mean, from Colorado, we all know that's like nothing. I'm at a higher elevation right now. But that's still pretty something, considering a lot of that area is much closer to sea level, and those are some decent peaks that get very cool temperatures, very high humidity, that low-hanging fog, like that sort of a type of environment where these guys are from. Now, all of this translates into captivity, like a lot of things. So, when we think about that, from that kind of cooler, humid, higher elevation type area, we have to think about that when it comes to husbandry. So first of all, we have to remember that these guys like cooler temperatures, oftentimes in the low 70s to low 80s as a basking spot. They definitely prefer cooler temperatures. And in the wild, their active period, or the time period when they're actually out and about and moving around and not in a state of brumation or hibernation, but brumation in this case, was a very limited amount of time, sometimes just May through September. And during that time, they have to grow very rapidly. And that's what happens. These guys have a tendency to grow pretty quickly in their first couple years, although for some reason, especially the females, do take a longer time to become sexually mature, sometimes over 5 years old. But they do grow in size quite rapidly because of, in the wild, they have a very short time period to do their feeding and growing. So in captivity, we have those cooler temperatures, that higher humidity, as well as they are fairly generalist. They will move up and down into the forest canopy, on the ground, under rocks, burrowing a little bit. So they're eating birds, they're eating reptiles, they're eating amphibians, they're eating mammals. And so in the hobby, we can give them a little bit more of a generalist feeding. Still plenty of rodents, but they actually usually tend to prefer smaller size meals than you would expect like a 6 foot snake to be eating, where you would normally be giving, you know, rat pups to winged rats, maybe even small rats to something like a large Texas rat snake of equivalent size. These guys are typically not eating very large ones, usually eating adult mice or jumbo mice or something similar, or reptilinks or maybe quail that they would be eating. So they usually prefer a smaller meal despite the fact growing very rapidly, which generally means as neonates or little babies, you're feeding them much more often. They have a little bit faster metabolism than say like a Western rat snake or maybe even like a king snake or corn snake or something similar. Now, with all that in mind, when we're keeping them, we have those lower temps again, the high humidity, the smaller prey items, the generalist variations. These guys do get fairly large, as we said at the beginning, over about 6 feet in length. So they also love to climb. So when we think about a good setup for these, we're thinking something that's going to be able to accommodate that full length of the animal, as well as at least 2-3 feet up. So that will allow them to be able to climb and move up and down and feel comfortable. Always give them that very low hot spot, some nice ultraviolet light, as well as plenty of places to hide. Potentially even elevated hives would be really cool because they will sometimes seek out hollowed out areas like a nesting bird or something inside of a hollowed out tree. These guys are very interesting and a really cool species to keep because in addition to being kind of more of a cooler weather reptile, these guys are known to be exceedingly calm and very bold. And by that, what I mean is that when we think about a lot of species of snakes, they're very cryptid, they're very secretive. It takes a long time for even captive bred animals to be comfortable with the daily movings on back and forth. And even in fact, when keeping animals in a high traffic area of your house, that can cause undue stress to your animals. And then they're out at different times, depending on the species, like ball pythons being very crepuscular. They're out in the late afternoon into the early evenings, early night. And then in the morning, some other species of snakes like bull snakes are out during the day and all sorts of ones. The Russian rat snakes are almost like the mailmen of snakes, where they're out rain or shine, day or night. And they, once established, they're very, very bold. They're very comfortable being exposed and just hanging out all the time, both on the ground and up in perches or platforms or ledges that you give them. They also aren't as wiry, is a word that I would like to describe some of like the North American rat snakes, like the grays, the blacks, the western rats, that even once they're older, they can be pretty calm. They move a lot more. They're a lot more reactive and like to their environment and to outside stimuli. These guys, they don't really run a whole lot. They're very deliberate with their emotions, which leads people to give them that very calm, inquisitive, curious nature, to where oftentimes when you open up the enclosure, sometimes they can be like, yeah, food, but they figure it out very quickly, to where they'll just kind of very calmly go, oh, okay, this is really cool. Just a really amazing species of snake that I absolutely do enjoy and love to be able to keep one of these days. I would love to be able to get a pair of Korean rat snakes and a pair of Russian rat snakes, although I'm not sure where I would put that, because I would want 2 6x2 for each one. And if I wanted them to be kept in pairs, because you can cohabitate them successfully, you just need to give them plenty of space. So I'd want like 2 8-foot by 3-foot by 3-foot enclosures for the Koreans and for the Russian, which would be really, really fun to do in a very nice, naturalistic enclosure. I should also probably mention that it is good for their health to actually let them go through a cooling period. A lot of people who keep lots of different species of clovers, myself included, don't give them a full brumation period unless you're breeding them. So for the people who keep bull snakes, pine snakes, king snakes, corn snakes, that type of animal, they do go through a natural brumation period where they normally come from, and it's actually good for them to kind of go through that nice little hibernation cycle. It's not 100% necessary in a lot of cases, but it is good for them. But with some species like rubber boas, or in the case of the Russian rat snakes and probably the Korean rat snakes, I need to do a little bit more research into that because they don't get quite far as north as the Russians do. They do really benefit and almost require a cooling period of temps below 60 degrees for at least a little while. A lot of people will bring down their Russian snakes, according to a lot of the different things that I read up on, down into the down into the low 50s, even high 40s for 2-3 months. And then they'll slowly bring them back up into temp and get them going, whether or not they're breeding them or not, after their first couple of years. Just an amazing species of snake that has been in the hobby for a little while that I'm starting to see a little bit of pickup of popularity. And I can see why, with kind of the onset of more internet celebrities being super into the boega, those mangrove snakes, and people either having more success in breeding Bolan's pythons, or they just have more of them in general, or they're bringing in large clutches. And so that really cool black and yellow snake is getting more popular, and so more people are going for these Russian rat snakes or potentially Korean rat snake babies until they get older and realize that that's not what they ended up with. So it's just really fun and a very interesting species of snake that is kept very differently than how we normally do, but would make it an amazing display animal as well as an animal to interact with, because of how calm and deliberate its movements are. I will say, as a final little fun note, and I've mentioned it because I brought up Russian rat snakes a couple times in videos past, but this is actually a species of snake that has made itself invasive in another part of the world. So we're all familiar with that term, invasive species, but there's an airport in the Netherlands where a small population of Russian rat snakes have actually managed to establish themselves. The general consensus is that someone released them either accidentally or was possibly in trouble with having them illegally and released them. But in going through this, I also discovered another story where supposedly they were kept in a greenhouse in the area and they were using them as natural, essentially, pest control, because obviously they'd be very good at it, but they managed to escape the greenhouses. And because they're used to living at a latitude or a longitude, they're used to living at a latitude and longitude very similar to the Netherlands, with those colder temperatures and those higher humidities, they managed to establish themselves and winter over and reproduce successfully in this very small area around the Netherlands airport. And right now, they're not making a whole lot of attempts to remove them. They're really studying them to see this type of impact they have on the environment and the ecosystem in this area. So just kind of a little interesting little tidbit there at the very end, that that's something that we should probably think about a little bit. But as responsible keepers, that's not something that we would ever want to do. Please don't release your animals, be it a dog, a cat, a rabbit, or a species of reptile. So, with that being said, hope you guys enjoyed this video. Please check out the whole Species Spotlight playlist. Big thanks to Braden Exotics again. I don't personally have the Russian rat snakes, but they were kind enough to let me do a little bit more B-roll, as with a lot of the other more recent Species Spotlights. And so all of the snakes that you saw in today's video are theirs. Just absolutely great. They're working on their website. I will, as I've said in other ones, make sure to retroactively post in their website once they have it established, but they're really starting to kind of build up what they are as kind of a little organization. So again, thank you so much for watching. Thank you, Braden Exotics. If you can, again, check out that playlist. Please like and subscribe if you can. Hope you're having a great day, and we'll check you next time.